Reddit, who is the most clever criminal in history? Back in the day, when there were casinos in Cuba, a man bought two cases of playing cards. He spent months carefully opening each new deck and marking each card in a way no one would notice. Then he resaled the two cartons and sold them in the local flea market. Now who would buy a whole case of cards, or two? After a while he started winning at poker in one of the casinos. Ultimately they knew he was cheating in the casino, but they never could catch him switching the deck. Very clever. Arno Funk. He demanded ransom for multiple department stores in Germany in the early 90s. There were 30 times where he tried to collect ransom money. He often used technical devices to fool the police. E.g. He wanted the money to be deployed in a box that was attached to a train. The police found a time control mechanism that would detach the package from the train at a specific time. The police found out when and where it would detach and positioned themselves at the expected location. However, Funk used a radio control to detach the package manually from the train much earlier than anticipated. He gave the order to deliver the money inside a stray sandbox and told the police that he would pick up the money. He spent numerous days in advance concealed as a construction worker to prepare the site. He placed the stray sandbox on top of a sewer opening and laid a thin layer of concrete around and under the stray sandbox. He waited under the sandbox, and after the police deployed the money he broke through the concrete and took the package unnoticed. When studying law at university I read a fantastic case in the law of contract that contained my favorite criminal ever. The best part being, no one knows who this guy is. McCreevy Commonwealth Disposals Commission. One very clever bunny managed to completely fabricate a cargo ship on paper. So this would have entailed ship berthing documentation, materials, cargo, health and safety checks, payroll for workers, all the licensing, and the list goes on seemingly forever. Basically, a lot of traceable items. On this particular ship's maiden voyage it sunk. Now for those of you that don't know, there are companies that specialize in salvaging wrecks for materials and cargo, with these bids for the salvage rights sometimes going into the tens, maybe hundreds of millions. So we now have a ship that exists on paper and is completely legitimate and has set sail and sunk with cargo, but was never physically built. This criminal now decides to sell these salvage rights to the Commonwealth Disposals Commission, who then hold an auction for the rights of salvage. Along comes the unfortunate McCree, who buys these rights. McCree assembles his divers, ships, and equipment that is also hideously expensive and heads on over to the location that the ship has reportedly sunk, only to find there is nothing there. McCree must have been furious, so brings her action against the Commonwealth Disposals Commission for breach of contract and subsequent damages, because the contract is between CDC and McCree. In the meantime, Mr. Clever Criminal has vanished. Turns out he was a real person, but using a bit of identity theft, probably really good at all of this smoke and mirrors facade with practice in making up ships. In my opinion, maybe this guy is one of the most intelligent people on the planet. That guy who stole like $12 million in diamonds, then stashed them, then turned himself in. There was some limit on the amount of time you can serve, something like 2 years. You get the idea. H. Holmes, a conman and one of the first known serial killers. If I remember the story correctly, he built a giant hotel full of secret passageways, false walls, and trapdoors during the Chicago World's Fair in 1893. He had a lot of fun with using different creative methods of killing people. You can tell he really loved what he did. He collected skeletons from his victims and had them processed and sold to medical schools, which turned him a big profit. It was estimated that his murder castle killed around 100 people. He was a wonderfully evil genius type character. I was born with the devil in me. I could not help the fact that I was a murderer, no more than the poet can help the inspiration to sing. I was born with the evil one standing as my sponsor beside the bed where I was ushered into the world, and he has been with me since. Mithilesh Kumis Ravastava, better known as Natwalal, 1912-2009, was a noted Indian con man, known for having repeatedly sold the Taj Mahal, the Red Fort, and the Rashtrapati Bhavan, and also the Parliament House of India along with its 545 sitting members. He was arrested 9 times throughout his life, but was able to break out of jail and run away every single time. The last time he was arrested was in 1996, and was 84 years old at that time. But he managed to again give the police a slip, and was last seen by authorities on June 24, 1996, when the wheelchair-using octogenarian vanished while being transported from prison to a hospital for treatment. I hope someone sees this. It's an awesome story. Back when bank transfers required actual physical currency, one man managed to walk away with a massive amount of money with nothing but a phone call. I'll try to find a link so I get the story right, otherwise I'll recall it as best I can. Okay, I couldn't find a link, which is a shame. So here is my version, which is probably wrong on some point or other. The mint has a transfer scheduled to a bank for some huge amount of money. The bank officer comes by, picks up the cash, leaves. A minute later, the mint gets a call saying the transfer was going to the wrong bank. The bank gets a call from the mint saying, "Bring the money back, we made a mistake." The courier is sent back after his check-in call and puts the money back. It's still on the counter when the thief, disguised as a bank officer, walks in, takes the bag, walks out and is never seen again. No suspects, nothing. Oh shit, I just forgot about another guy. This guy's number one. For 30 years he manned a parking booth collecting fees at the London Zoo. Day in, day out, never missed a day. Pocketed every dime. 30 years and he just doesn't show up one day and the zoo calls the city to discover that there is no parking fee for the zoo. He made millions, tax-free, and just disappeared. John DeLena was quite incredible. The public absolutely adored him despite his violent/criminal streak. Even though he wasn't unique in that regard, the public also loved E.G. Capone, at least until the Valentine's Day massacre, and this was during the Depression, so opinions were rather easily swayed. I still think it's pretty cool. He had his cohorts impersonate officers to break him out of prison. He used hostages as human shields. I'm not condoning or celebrating what he did, but the words criminal mastermind come to mind when I think of him. I would have to go with the angel of death, Josef Mengele. I mean, the dude is just one of the most vile human beings in history. The things he did to people should not be real. The kind of horrors he put them through should not be experienced by any person. He was responsible for thousands of deaths in concentration camps, and then there are people he didn't send to the camps. They had a much worse fate. What they experienced was so cruel that it sounds like something out of a storybook. Despite all these atrocities, he was never captured and lived his life in South America until he died in 1979. I didn't want to go into detail about the cruel acts he committed, but if you're curious, here you go. I don't know if the most clever in history, but in 2007 one František Procházka stole more than half a billion Czech crowns cash, over 20 million euros at the time, from a very well-known security agency, and he basically walked out of the door with it. He was working at the company. It is said that from the beginning he had planned getting a job there, to know how everything worked to the last detail. On the day of the robbery, his partner drove with a van marked with the logos of the company, apparently the bought one that the company had used, or something like that. They loaded the cash in the back and drove away. His accomplice was caught and, I think, sentenced. Procházka hasn't been caught yet. As far as I know, the closest was 3 years ago, when he was spotted in the Dominican Rep. Most criminals are decidedly not clever. However, Ted Kaczynski was caught because his sister-in-law suspected he might be the Unabomber. The FBI had very little to go on before Ted Kaczynski's brother David contacted the FBI and provided them with letters Ted Kaczynski had written in the 70s. The Zodiac Killer is also a well-known example of a clever criminal, but almost as mysterious was the Cleveland Torso Murderer of the 1930s. Elliot Ness couldn't crack the case, but suspected it was Drive. Francis E. Sweeney. Drive. Sweeney later voluntarily had himself committed due to mental illness issues, but sent the Ness family taunting letters until the 1950s. Ted Bundy deserves a mention. In a diabolical way, killing dozens of women, only reason cops first caught him, because he deliberately decided to speed in front of one. His escape from jail was pretty amazing, and while defending himself in court, the judge stated he was most impressed with his legal knowledge, then he sentenced him to death. He was executed in 1989 here in Florida. If he had committed his murders in California, of course, he'd still be alive today, Florida officials said. When the time came, unlike most death row inmates, he did not go to the electric chair willingly. J.D. McMahon swindled investors out of a bunch of money by telling them he was going to build a skyscraper. In the plans for the building, he put inches instead of feet, and the investor signed off on the blueprints, which allowed him to escape justice. I actually learned that one from another Reddit thread. Jonathan Wild. Essentially, he was simultaneously the highest ranking law enforcement officer in London and the most powerful gang leader. His usual scam ran like this: someone would report something stolen, Wild would find the thief and return the item, and collect the reward. He would then share the reward with the thief, who worked for him. The truly ingenious part is how he dealt with dissent in his gang, or with rival gangs encroaching on his territory. He simply turned them in. It is estimated that 60 people were executed, based on his testimony. When he started, there was a £40 reward for evidence against a thief, but he lobbied to get it raised to £140, about $6,700 USD. I remember reading an article a year or so ago about an 18 or 20 year old kid that convinced his pair in Northern Virginia that he was a CIA official and instructed them to rob banks in order to test the bank's security systems as a CIA operation. He told the two that they wouldn't get in trouble, and they robbed a couple of banks before the cops got them. The guy posing as the CIA operative, I think, got 2 months in a mental institution or something, but it wasn't anything major. Charles Manson. He used a combination of religious and persuasive techniques to convince dozens of men and women into believing that a major race war was coming, to murder one of the most well-known actresses of the time who was pregnant, among many other murders, to migrate around the Western U.S., and that he could predict the future based off the Beatles' White Album. Lance Armstrong. A better than average cyclist systematically doped himself and his team into 7 Tour de France wins. Tens if not hundreds of millions in prizes and sponsorship. Bullied and slash or sued anyone who raised it as a possibility. President on speed dial massive charity. Was considering politics before being exposed. Epic criminal. Epic nut. Everyone knows about George Jung and the movie Blow, but the best part of that entire story is Digo. His real name was Carlos Ledger, and he truly bought smuggling cocaine to a whole different level. He bought an island in the Bahamas, was guerrilla, participated in Colombian politics, ran with Escobar, Noriega, and Jung, evaded the CIA, and has a bit of a fuzzy prison sentence. Oh, and he also had a $2.7 billion net worth. According to several of my lunatic conservative Christian coworkers, Obama is the cleverest criminal ever. Yes, they attribute all kinds of crazy things to our president. He stole the election twice. He ordered the Sandy Hook massacre. He is giving away our secrets to the Chinese. Last week, the looniest one of them all was telling anyone that would listen to him that Obama was secretly funneling $2 trillion to ISIS. Yes, trillion. He also says the internet is under the president's control. That's why he can't find any more info into that issue. I could go on and on, but it is making me sick. Nauseous. O_0. The guy who paid out of pocket to have a toll booth installed in a public parking lot. He collected parking tolls for 14 years. Something like £7.4 million. Averaging £500,000 a year. Not bad. They also never caught the guy that did it. Basically, all the guy did was sit in a box, watch TV, and have people hand him money. I saw a documentary once about the Russian mafia, and they had a scam where they took vodka, dyed it blue, and shipped it in plastic 55-gallon drums labeled as windshield washer fluid. Once it got to the destination country, they added another chemical that made the blue precipitate out. They apparently made an insane amount of money in liquor taxes avoided. It was one of their all-time biggest money makers. Jonathan Tockerly Parry. He was an antiquities restorer that used his talents to disguise Egyptian artifacts as souvenirs and then shipped them to Europe through duty-free to be sold on the black market. Foiled by his assistant in 1994 by taking 27 papyrus texts to the British Museum to confirm their authenticity, the curator told Scotland Yard, etc. More information can be found here. Apparently the British Museum didn't like anyone else getting in on their "we are going to take Egyptian artifacts and not repatriate them" bit. Frederick Bourdin, a French man who assumed the identity of hundreds of people, notably the identity of a missing child. He lived with the family for a while before being found out. The fact that he was found in Spain years later and made it to the US with a new passport and identity just shows how good of an actor he is. A couple movies were made about him, The Imposter and The Chameleon.